you doing there?
The Lord now welcomes her to the table of God's children in heaven. With faith and hope and eternal life, let us assist her with our prayer. Let us pray to the Lord also for ourselves. May we who mourn be reunited one day with our sister. Together we may meet Jesus when he who is our life appears in glory. We read in the Gospel of Matthew, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, says the Lord, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Lord Jesus Christ, of your faith, bless this place of rest of our beloved sister Epiphany. Our sister may sleep here in peace until you awake her to glory. For you are the rest self from this life to himself. We commit her body to the earth from which she was formed. For we are dust, and into dust we shall return. But the Lord Jesus Christ will change our mortal bodies to be like his in glory. For he is risen, the firstborn from the dead. So let us commit our sister to the Lord, that the Lord may embrace her in peace and raise it up on the last day. Our sister, Epiphany, and anointed with the Holy Spirit, give her the fellowship of your saints, we pray to the Lord. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table of your heavenly kingdom. Do not count her deeds against her, for in her heart she desired to do your will. As her faith unite her to the people on earth, so may your mercy join her to the angels in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. There you
go. I'm Caroline, and this is my sister Jennifer. We're Offie's daughters, and we're also Epifania's granddaughters. We know her as Lala. Epifania Ramirez Flores was born on April 7, 1912 in Lobo, Batangas, Philippines. She was a daughter of Cristobal Ramirez and Martina Abron. Lala had one sister and two brothers. She attended elementary school in Lobo, high school in Batangas City, and college at Philippine Normal College and the National Teachers College. Lawless studied to be an elementary school teacher and after graduation taught at Lobo Elementary School. Lala met and married Lamberto Flores in 1937 and had four children, Ophelia, Nora, Ernesto, and Francisco. They eventually moved from Lobo to Mamboro, Occidental Mindoro, and continued to teach elementary school until she retired at the age of 58. When Lola was assigned as provincial treasurer of Oriental Mindoro, they moved to Calapan, then to Manila after Lola retired. Lolo and Lola lived a full and busy life. They were fortunate enough to send all of their children to college despite financial challenges and difficulties. In 1970, Lola visited Tita Nora's family in the U.S. for the first time and stayed for a year to take care of Jet and Narel. After Lola retired from treasurer of Calapan, they returned to the U.S. to visit their family. Oh, visit my family. They originally planned to stay for 1 month, but ended up staying 10 years because they wanted to take care of Michelle, Jennifer, and me. During their stay, they traveled throughout the U.S. In 1987, they returned to the Philippines to enjoy their retirement and live with Tito Paquito and Tita Alice. Lola passed away in 1991, at which time Lola returned to the U.S. to live with Tita Nora in California for the next 15 years. Lola lived in Yucaipa, where she helped Tita Nora's board and care, and after Yucaipa, they moved to Redlands. She later moved to Murrieta and eventually lived with Tita Paquito and Tita Alice again. Lola enjoyed spending time with her 13 grandchildren and 5 great-grandchildren. Lola showed us by taking care of herself, she was able to remain youthful, both physically and mentally. Lola was a natural beauty. She never wore makeup or put any creams on her face and never went to a salon to get her hair done. People were always surprised to find out that Lola was in her 90s because she definitely didn't look her age. She was a beautiful person, both inside and out, with beautiful soft skin. And as Lolo used to say, she had great legs. In her daily life, Lolo was a strong woman who was self-sufficient until she was 93. She would cook for herself, clean up, and keep her strict routine. She maintained a healthy, balanced diet, and her favorite meal was fish and rice. A sweet dessert almost always ended her meals, too. Her daily schedule also included reading, watching the Filipino channel to stay connected to the Philippines, taking naps, and regular exercise. Every day, she would see or speak to all of her children and was always available for advice, comfort, or a loving smile. During our many visits here to California, we adopted Lola's routine. We ate together, we napped at the same times, and held hands while we watched the Filipino channel. She would enjoy our back and leg massages, but we were always careful not to rub her ankles too hard or tickle her feet. Our most memorable moments were when we had alone time. I loved her comments and her concern for all of us. Regardless of what was going on back in New York, being in her presence just made us feel better. We were fortunate to have these moments to share our thoughts, go through many pictures, or just watch her as she slept. We have fond memories of Lala doing her daily fast-paced walking around the house like she was on a racetrack. Even when she began using a walker, she still continued her high-speed exercise, and it seemed to make her even faster. 2 years ago, after being faced with a stroke, Lola fought weakness and frustration to regain her speech and her strength through physical and speech therapy. Because she already had been taking care of herself and was in such good shape, Lala was successful in overcoming all these obstacles. Lala loved nature and all of God's creatures and showed it through her passion and action. She lovingly cared for our various pets and all kinds of animals outdoors. Lala had a strong love and talent for creating the most beautiful gardens at all of the homes she lived in. She spent countless hours outdoors tending to the flowers, plants, and fruit trees. In any free moment she and Lala had, they were diligently planting or physically tending to their gardens. She made beauty out of rocky, barren soil and showed us that with hard work and love, anything can be accomplished. Though Lala was a teacher by trade and education, she aimed to teach her family important life lessons. Growing up, we all knew how generous Lala was. She was always sending clothes, toys, and household items to the Philippines. She taught us to value what we had because there were less fortunate people who were hungry and didn't have many things. Thinking of others in need was a priority for Lala. And she was always very thoughtful, never wanting to inconvenience her family. We would constantly ask her if she needed anything, like a fresh glass of water, a back massage, or if she wanted us to raise the volume of the TV. If she thought it might be a bother to someone, she would say her common phrases, "Never mind," or "It's okay." Lala always valued education and stressed to her children and grandchildren the importance of getting a college degree and higher education. Even before her grandchildren attended school, Lala was teaching them the alphabet, reading, and Tagalog. For many years, she was teaching herself Spanish and spent many hours studying textbooks and creating her own phrase books. Age never stopped Lala from continuing to learn. At the age of 90, Lala became an American citizen, and she took it very seriously. She studied American history, prepared her notes, and tested herself to make sure that she would pass. Lala's teachings went beyond the books. She taught us strong family values, to study and work hard, stressed good manners, and always encouraged us to be kind to others. From a very young age, Lala would teach us the importance of faith and our relationship with God. She taught us prayers and would pray with us every night. Lala was concerned about her family's well-being and always thinking of us. When anyone had a big exam or a job interview coming up, she would pray for us and ask God to help us get through it. Lala would always let us know how proud she was of us. She would be so thrilled at our accomplishments and send us supportive cards at holidays. Best of all, she would always make sure we all knew that she loved us. Lala enjoyed reading the Dear Abby advice column, but often gave her own loving advice to her family. She would write letters to her grandchildren, reminding us to be good, respect your elders, to be good to your parents, and always know how hard they work. And most of all, we should all love each other. She was always stressing the importance of family to all of us, encouraging the family to take care of each other. We are so blessed to have such an incredible Lala, who was able to teach us proper values, show us how to persevere through setting a good example, and to enrich our lives with her unconditional love. Today it is important that we all celebrate Lala's full life, and we continue to follow and pass on her valuable life lessons.
With White Wings Ceremony Company. I'm very honored to have the family's invitation to join you to present this final flight as part of your tribute of love, affection, and farewell to Epifania. The releasing of this dove in a few moments by a family member is going to represent a symbolic departure of Epifania's spirit, rising up to meet the embrace of her Lord and Creator. On our behalf, the releasing of this dove represents an expression of our faith that we willingly release and surrender Epifania to make this journey. Well, as this little dove starts today, she will start all alone. But then she's going to be joined in the sky by a four-dove escort. Those four doves represent the love and the affection of the immediate family, most especially Epifania's children. Somewhere way off in the distance, quite possibly beyond the buildings and the trees here in Temecula, this little single dove will recognize those doves following behind her as her family. And because she does, she will make a great effort to circle all the way back to join with them. They join together to remind us of a better, more hopeful and joyous time of reunion. For our Heavenly Father is going to give us that most precious gift of seeing Epifania again, and indeed all of our family members that we have loved and lost. And at that time, we are going to celebrate a great reunion in the sky. And of course, these little doves, as they complete the journey that we're asking of them today, they're going to fly all the way here from the Temecula area, all the way back to their home, which is near the city of San Bernardino. If Epifania could have shared some inspirational thoughts with you today, she might have considered thoughts like these. This poem is called, I Am Free. Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard his call. I turned my back, I left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work, or play. Tasks left undone must stay that way, but I found that peace at the close of the day. If my parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Oh yes, these things I too will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow, for I wish you the sunshine of tomorrow. For my life was full, I savored much, good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seemed all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your hearts and share with me. God wanted me now, and he has set me free.
And the lovely day is through, then with longing I recall the years I spent with you. Mamma, solo per te la mia canzone. Sarai con me, tu non sarai più sola. Quanto ti voglio bene, queste parole d'amore che ti sospiro il mio cuore. Forse non s'usano più, mamma, ma la canzone mia più bella sei tu. Se per la vita non ti lascio mai più. Until the day that we're together.